I will stop. Thank you all for being here. I am pleased to introduce Kelli Evans, whose biography I don't have in front of me, but she has this fabulous background. She's associate director, associate director of the ACLU of Northern California, which is one of our top staff positions, and she has a sterling degree, has multiple degrees, and a sterling experience, which I have not committed to memory. She's here to talk to us about what the ACLU is doing and grassroots efforts and why we should all be happy to be here and involved in this stuff. And welcome, Kelli. Thank you for coming to talk with us.
Thank you, everyone. I'm taking my phone out to look at the clock, and I'd love the government to hear this speech, so I hope they are listening. I want to thank the chapter for inviting me here today. I'll tell you a little bit about my background, which will make you understand why I'm so happy to be in this room right now. I'm a civil rights attorney by background, training, and experience, and I've spent a lot of my career before coming to the ACLU about a year and a half ago to become the associate director. I spent a lot of my career working on police accountability issues, the type of issues that Deborah mentioned, trying to decrease excessive force, trying to decrease racial profiling, trying to decrease Fourth Amendment violations by the police. I was the federal court-appointed monitor of the Oakland, California Police Department for about 7 years, and that department has a whole lot of serious issues, and it's why they're under federal court supervision right now. And before that, I was a civil rights attorney in private practice in Washington, D.C. But before that, I spent several years in the Department of Justice in the Clinton administration in the Civil Rights Division doing investigations for the Civil Rights Division of police departments of prisons and jails when there are civil rights violations by those entities, exactly what the government should be doing. George Bush was elected, and they decided to pretty much close up the Civil Rights Division, so I left position. But while I was there, I had the opportunity to go to large police departments, small police departments, mid-sized ones, big prison systems, small jails, everywhere from New York State to dealing with NYPD to teeny tiny jails in rural Appalachia, and to see up close and personal the harm that can happen when our public officials, in these cases, our law enforcement agencies, are not accountable. And that's where we come in. That's where the ACLU comes in. We have to demand transparency, and we have to make sure that our voices are heard, because it's just too easy for the government to get on a track and exercise their enormous powers in ways that cause tremendous harm. So that's a little bit by way of my background. I'm really, really happy to be here today. I think that right now, from my perspective, I can hardly think of a more exciting or important time to be involved in the ACLU. There are so many vital civil rights and civil liberties issues happening all across the country, and right here in California in particular. And they're issues that really need all of us to speak out on and all of us to participate about. And it makes a difference when we participate, a big difference. It can make a small difference or a big difference. I wanted to share a little anecdote with you about how quick grassroots participation can have an almost immediate impact in some cases. How many of you heard about the BART Police Department's decision a few weeks ago to shut down cell service to disrupt a protest? Just about everyone. So BART got wind that demonstrators were going to protest BART's shooting and killing of one of its passengers. BART didn't want passengers to criticize BART's activities, so BART used technology to shut down cell service in the BART service. And so, they were trying to censor not only people who were going to protest BART, but they also shut down everyone's communication. So people that were, trying to go pick up their children or meet their friends for dinner or maybe having a medical emergency and needed to ask for medical assistance, all communications shut down by BART. And, when this happens in other countries, we rightfully criticize and think of them as repressive regimes. And so it was mind-blowing that this happened in San Francisco just a few weeks ago. And, initially BART was very, very recalcitrant. They didn't want to admit that they had screwed up, and they were not willing to say that they weren't going to do this again, absent having a very, very, very good reason. And wanting to stifle a protest is not a good reason. So they were recalcitrant, so I set up a meeting with the Bard police chief, me and a couple of our staff attorneys, and we were scheduled to go over and meet with him one afternoon a couple weeks ago. But a couple hours before I went over, we sent out an action alert to our ACLU members. And so we contacted lots of our ACLU members via email, and we asked people to please contact the BART Police Department and tell them no more censorship on BART. That, you know, this is contrary to our rights to free speech and our rights of association. And so I went to the meeting with the police chief at BART, and we were having a meeting with the police chief. He was being a little cagey, a little squirrely, and at some point, fairly early in the meeting, about 15 minutes into the meeting, he just sort of glanced at his BlackBerry, and he had this alarmed look on his face, and he said, "I have 250 emails from ACLU members." And I said, "Well, our members care deeply about free speech." And so he was a little shaken, and we continue the meeting, and about 30 minutes into the meeting, he looks again. He says, "I'm up to 450 emails."
Yay!
And so he's giving me this running count, and after about 45 minutes, he's up to 750 emails. And
wow.
The last count I had, we met with him for a little over an hour, the last count I had, he was up to nearly 1,000 emails from ACLU members. And his attitude started to change during the course of the meeting. And the emails kept coming in even after we left the meeting. And since that time, BART sort of seems to have recognized that it made a mistake, and has committed to coming up with a policy to keep the BART police chief or whoever made this decision from going down this road again. But an example of, you know, lots of people, ACLU members and others, joining together quickly to say that this is not okay and you can't do this in our name. The sort of speaking out that Deborah talked about a minute ago is so, so critical. And it makes a difference. It can make a big difference. What I wanted, you know, the ACLU works on so many different issues, which is why it's a really exciting organization to work for and to be involved with. But because we work on so many different issues, there's no way I could talk about them all today. So what I wanted to do was focus on two big areas that we do a lot of work in. And one is dealing with student rights. We do a lot of work with students and student rights and a lot of different issues. And the other area I want to talk about today is criminal justice reform, and that's because there's a lot needed in this area and also a lot happening in California right now. So with respect to student rights, I thought I'd share with you some recent cases that we're working on, some recent advocacy that we're doing, and some of it you all already know about. We do a range of students' rights advocacy. We work to make schools safe for all kids, welcoming, inclusive for all kids. We work to protect students' constitutional rights. You know, we believe that students don't leave the Constitution at the door when they come in. They still have their constitutional rights, although unfortunately the courts have cut away at that some over the years. We do a lot of work on behalf of students, and there are a few students that we've worked with in recent years that I just wanted to share with you their stories. We're working right now with a student just down the street in Davis who was a student journalism for her high school newspaper at the Davis High School. And we were shocked to learn that this student, this high school journalism student, and another student, an advanced placement calculus student, on three separate occasions had the Davis police officers come to the school, detain these students, take away their cell phones, not allow them to contact their parents, and interrogate them, not tell them their rights, not allow them to talk to any adults. Three separate times this happened. And we were trying to figure out what on earth is going on. You know, we have seen that, and I think in part as a result of the war on drugs, we've seen police presence creep into schools more and more over the past decade or so. And so we were wondering, why are the police so urgently wanting to interrogate these students? Well, they weren't wanted for any crimes, as you might think. Well, maybe that would be a reason. The student journalist had written an article for the student newspaper about graffiti artists. She wasn't a suspect. The police had an urgent desire to see if she would identify the sources for her article so they could maybe get to the root of some graffiti that maybe happened in Davis off campus. So because of this, she's not a criminal suspect, yet they treat her like a suspect, not like a student. So we are working with the student right now, and we've told the school district that this is absolutely unacceptable, that they have violated the students' rights, and that we're demanding that the school district rethink how it interacts with the local law enforcement, because the thing here is that the school district and the school officials were complicit. The police officers didn't just bust down the doors and go in. School officials were complicit in this. And so we're demanding that the school officials change how they interact with local law enforcement, that they train staff about students' rights, that they advise students about their rights, and that they respect those students' rights, that they train their staff. And so we're hopeful that we'll be able to stop those, you know, over-aggressive, unconstitutional practices in Davis, and then lift up what I hope to be a victory there and take it out to other schools. And when I am sort of talking about treating students as suspects rather than students, this is happening a lot. And so I'm really happy to report that just a couple weeks ago, we settled a lawsuit on behalf of three students that we were representing out of Shasta. And the Shasta Union Unified School District, they came up with the brilliant idea to use their resources to do suspicionless drug testing of students. So no suspicion that kids were using drugs, but they thought, well, you know, kids who are involved in risky activities like Future Farmers of America, Trimathlon, Flute Ensemble, Band, those students, we gotta see if they're using drugs. So the school initiated this, you know, suspicionless drug testing policy and program, and what they would do is they pull kids out of class, put them in a bathroom, have them pee in a cup, have someone standing outside listening while the student urinated. Incredibly invasive and embarrassing, and absolutely no common sense justification for this. There's just, the research shows that students who are involved in these activities are in fact far less likely than other students to use drugs. But, you know, the school was sending the wrong message, that if you want to participate in these positive curricular and extracurricular activities, we're going to make you pee in a cup, and we're going to listen outside the door. So we represented three students, including this incredible young woman named Brittany Dalton, who was a champion flute player. And she was just mortified about this. And her father told the district, look, we don't agree with this, but we'll allow her to give the sample, but we want a private company to do it off of school grounds. This is just too embarrassing. The schools wouldn't listen, just totally blew the family off. And they said that they were not going to allow Brittany to play in the championship flute ensemble. I'm not a flautist, so I don't know what they're called. Meet. I don't know if they say flute meets or that was coming up, unless she did this. Well, we went in and we filed a lawsuit, and we asked the court to order them to allow her to perform without doing the drug test. The court agreed with us, so the wonderful result in Brittany's case, she was able to perform, and she and her ensemble actually took a top prize in the state competition, so that was wonderful. And so, you know, we were in court for a couple years with the district. They were just adamant that they were in their right in doing this. But every court that looked at this issue agreed with us. The lower court, the Shasta Union Superior Court, and the California Court of Appeals said that this doesn't make any sense. This is a violation of the student's constitutional rights. And so finally, the school district has abandoned its appeal, and we reached a settlement with them earlier this month. So they've dropped their drug testing, and we hope we can dissuade other districts from going down that path. So that's really good. And then the third student story I want to share with you involves Seth Walsh. I don't know how many of you have heard of Seth. A few people have. We have done historically a lot of work on school climate issues. I mentioned briefly ago trying to make schools welcoming, inclusive places for all students, including students of color, including lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender students. A lot of our school advocacy in recent years and our LGBT work in specific has focused on schools because there's such a dire need. Last summer and fall, in fact, there was, I don't know how much you heard about it, but there was this tragic rash of suicides by young gay people across the country. In the month of September alone, there were at least six young gay people who killed themselves because of anti-gay bullying and harassment, including Seth Walsh. Now, Seth was here in California. Seth, after enduring years and years of harassment, he was 13 years old when he died. After enduring years and years of harassment, he hung himself from his family's plum tree. He was on life support for several days, and Seth died almost exactly a year ago. It'll be a year ago next week that Seth died. And the harassment with Seth started when he was in about fifth grade and intensified. His mother, Wendy Walsh, tried repeatedly. She contacted numerous school officials to complain about the harassment her son was facing, but they really turned a deaf ear and a blind eye. And as a result, the harassment and bullying intensified. So by the time that Seth got to middle school, he was regularly being taunted with, you know, words like queer, words like faggot. It was even reported to us that a teacher called Seth or referred to Seth as fruity in front of a bunch of other students. You know, Seth felt like he had no way out as a 13-year-old. He took his own life. And he's not the only child in this situation. And I don't know how his mother, Wendy, does it, where she finds the strength, but she's turning her personal tragedy, trying to make a difference for other children here in California and across the country. So she has joined with us in calling for an end to harassment and bullying here in California and across the country. Lawyers in our office at the ACLU of Northern California, we drafted a law this legislative session that we are calling that is known as Seth's Law, and it's a law that has passed both houses in Sacramento. It's sitting on the governor's desk. And what this law would do is strengthen anti-bullying, anti-harassment protections in California schools, strengthen up the policies and procedures, and actually require, place an affirmative duty on teachers and administrators to intervene when they learn about harassment happening. So that's on the governor's desk. So when you have a chance to take a look at our web, it's called Seth's Law, you can look it up on our website, or if you do a Google search, you can look it up. If you follow Deborah's advice and if you get onto the internet, onto our website, we'd love for you to take action on the cell phone bill to say police should not be able to search our cell phones absent a warrant. Please ask the governor to sign that bill. Please also ask the governor to sign Seth's Law. They're two of the laws that are on his desk right now awaiting signature. So those are a few of the students' rights cases that our staff have been working on over the past several months I wanted to share with you. And then I wanted to turn now to criminal justice reform. And in my mind, the topic of schools and students and the topic of criminal justice reform are very much connected. And that's because we, in this state and as a society, are diverting so many of our young people into the criminal justice system. And so many of our resources, so many of our tax dollars are being diverted away from schools and education and into the criminal justice system. So I think that's probably why subconsciously I decided to talk about these two topics today. And when I'm talking about criminal justice reform, I think with the group that's in this room, it's a luxury. I don't have to explain to you all how broken our criminal justice system is. It's in a complete shambles. And a big part of why it's broken is because of the war on drugs that I mentioned briefly a moment ago. You know, the war on drugs this year marked its 40th anniversary, although it really sort of started getting ramped up in the mid-80s. And from the mid-1980s to the mid-2000s, our prison population has tripled. Meanwhile, crime rates have remained about the same and, in fact, have declined some. And our recidivism rate here in California is insane. We have one of the highest recidivism rates in the country. It's at about 68%. And what I mean when I say this is that within 3 years of being released from prison here in California, people end up back in prison. About 68% of the people within 3 years of being released end up back in prison. Okay? Our system is simply not working. You know, it's not making us any safer. It's draining resources from our educational services, from our health and human services. Something is broken. And so we've been trying to do work in this space. And unfortunately, California is really behind the times. There are other places across the country where innovation is happening, other places that are starting to bring down their prison and jail populations, and some unexpected places like Texas, places like Mississippi, who are starting to realize that, you know, it's insane to keep locking up thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of our people, that there's nothing productive that is coming out of that. And I was sharing with Alan before I got up here, here in California, in our jails at the county level, between 60 and 70% of the people who are clogging up our jails in California are people who have not been convicted of a crime. These are people who are there pre-trial, okay? And they're not there primarily because they present a public safety risk, but many of them are there because they can't afford to post bail. Others are there because of political cowardice. Politicians are very, very afraid of an incident possibly happening and someone saying, why didn't you keep that person locked up? Well, the reality is, you know, our system of justice, we have a presumption of innocence. And it's the responsibility of our lawmakers and our public officials to manage risk and to improve our public safety. And the current system isn't doing that at all. There's no rationality there that's happening. But there are opportunities right now that we haven't had in a long time in California. There's a little bit of a perfect storm brewing right now that gives us, as civil liberties advocates, I think an entree to make some real changes. And there are a couple things going on. As you all know, our state is broke. We're in a financial recession, and we are predicted to not have many resources as a state for, you know, the next several years to come. So there are incredible budgetary pressures on our state government right now and on our local governments right now. At the same time, the U.S. Supreme Court, just a couple months ago, ordered the state of California to reduce the population in our state prisons. This was in a case called PLATA, P-L-A-T-A. The U.S. Supreme Court issued this order because the conditions in our state prison, largely due to overcrowding, are so abysmal that they're creating an incredibly dangerous environment for staff and for inmates alike. And so the Supreme Court, it's a really striking case. If you have a chance to read it, it's worth it. It details the horror show that is happening at in our state prisons right now. Lots of unavoidable deaths, inadequate medical care, inadequate mental health care, no meaningful rehabilitation or programming going on, just warehousing in a very, very dangerous way. So the Supreme Court said that violates the Constitution. And it takes a lot for the Supreme Court to say that conditions in a prison violate the Constitution. But the Supreme Court said that this year and has ordered the state of California to reduce our state prison population by about 33,000 people over the next couple of years. So the state has this U.S. Supreme Court court order. It also doesn't have much money. Those two things together are going to, I think, help work in a way for us to move criminal justice policy in a positive direction in California. In order to address this state court order that's ordering the reduction in state prisons, the governor has come up with a plan. It's called criminal justice realignment. Have any of you heard about that? A few people. The number of the bill, it was Assembly Bill 109. And what this law does is very interesting. What it does is it says that starting October 1st, so just a few days from now, starting October 1st, people that are convicted of certain low-level, nonviolent crimes will no longer be sent to state prison, but instead, they'll be the responsibility of the individual counties to supervise. And I say supervise. So that means, you know, it was sort of insanity for low-level, nonviolent people to be spending time in state prison to begin with. But now, these people are going to be the responsibility of local counties. And the counties have a lot of flexibility in terms of how they supervise them. They could continue to do business as usual, what we know doesn't work in terms of public safety or the economics, and they could simply try to put those people, in their county jails. But the truth is, there isn't room at the inn in many, many counties to simply put that population in county jails. So what does this mean? It means that counties are being forced to take a look at what makes sense. And we know what makes sense. Study after study has shown that what makes sense for, you know, crimes that are caused by drug addiction is drug treatment. You know, that's where we get our bang for our buck. What makes sense for property crimes is restitution, not putting someone in a cage. These are things that make sense. And there are also things that are a lot less expensive than jail beds or prison cells. So the counties now are going to be forced to do this analysis and figure out how they're going to deal with these new responsibilities. The law passed earlier this spring, early summer, and within days of it being passed, the ACLU, we sprang into action. We wrote a report called Community Safety, Community Solutions. It's on our website, the website that Deborah gave out earlier. And in our website, we put forth a 12-step plan, if you will, because we believe that the state is addicted to incarceration, so we came up with a 12-step plan to guide counties for how they can take, you know, the best advantage of this new law and their new responsibilities. And we talk a lot about the need for counties to prioritize and implement alternatives to incarceration, because there are things that work, there are things that make our communities more safe. Because the last thing we want is for people to get out of state prison or to get out of jail and still have a drug addiction problem, still be illiterate, still have no job prospects, still have anger management problems, still not have stable housing, still not be able to take care of their children, on and on and on. So what we need to do is get our county officials and use our scarce public safety dollars to deal with those underlying issues. And this process is playing out in every county throughout the state, so in 58 counties right now, and there is an opportunity for all of you to get involved on the local level. And the more our officials hear from us, and the officials who are involved in coming up with these plans are the chief probation officer, the district attorney, the public defender, the presiding judge of the county, those are the key players. There are also health officials and police chiefs that are participating as well. The more they hear from people like us in the community saying, we don't just want you to lock everyone up. We want you to do what makes sense, what stops more victims from happening, what helps people get on the right track. Alan Ash has been participating in the local process here in Sacramento, and I would encourage you all to join them. We have been working with ACLU activists across the state to get this message out, and so I would really, really ask you to join us in that. And this is another example of why it's so important to be involved with an organization like the ACLU and how we can make a difference. I think, you know, some of the counties are wanting to just spend the money that the state is giving them for their new responsibilities to build or reopen jails, and that some of that discussion is happening here in Sacramento. Other counties are saying, you know, we're going to open up an adult day reporting center where we're going to have job training, where we're going to have drug treatment, where we're going to have other things. Others are saying, you know, it doesn't make sense to put people in jail who don't pose a risk to public safety. Instead, they could be in home detention, which is a whole lot cheaper. And you know what? Someone who's in home detention who has a job, they're able to keep that job. They're able to maintain a relationship with their family. We don't further destabilize them. By putting low-level people in who have stable housing, who have stable jobs, we destabilize them. We make them lose their jobs. We make them lose their housing. And so it's no wonder that our recidivism rate is so high. So I guess I have a few asks for you today. And the first one is, because you're here, you're probably an ACLU member, but if you're not, please, please become one, because the more members we have, the more political clout we have in Sacramento and throughout the country, and the more resources we have to do this incredibly vital work. Renew your membership if it has lapsed. Ask other people to join us. There are so many issues we work on. There's not a single person I know, myself included, that agrees with every position the ACLU takes, not including the president of the ACLU or a single board member or a single staff member. But that's the beauty of the ACLU. There are principles that we stand for, and those principles apply to all of us. So join, renew, ask others to join us. With respect to this criminal justice stuff, get involved in Sacramento. This new law is going into effect October 1st, but your county right now is working on the plan. And the more of us that they hear from that we want alternatives to incarceration, we want things that make sense, the more they're going to be likely to do that. And then the third thing I want to mention is something that I actually haven't talked about yet. Some of you may have heard, we announced just a few weeks ago a campaign to end the death penalty in California. It's called the Safe California Campaign, and I'm sure most people here know about the state of Georgia's execution of Troy Davis last week. You know, as long as we have a death penalty in California or any place in this country, we run the risk of executing more innocent people. You know, that's what Georgia did last week. The death penalty is costing our state hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars. It's not doing a damn thing to make any of us any safer. It's barbaric. It's something that, you know, the United States in the world, in the sort of the community of the world, increasingly we stand alone in continuing this barbaric, expensive practice. So we've announced a campaign to have a ballot initiative in 2012 to end the death penalty in California, to replace the death penalty with life without the possibility of parole, with the requirement that people who have these life sentences be required to work, be required to pay restitution. And because the death penalty is so expensive, we were able to carve out a significant portion of the savings each year, about $30 million each year that we would save if we replaced the death penalty. $30 million each year we could redirect towards law enforcement to actually solve unsolved homicides, to solve unsolved rapes. Right now, the rate of unsolved homicides and unsolved rapes and sexual assaults in our state is through the roof. It's about 50 to 60% of all homicides and all rapes are going unsolved. So there's a better use for our public safety dollars than having this death penalty system that is so broken that it cannot be fixed. So I would ask you to please go to our website, go to the Safe California campaign website, and get involved in that campaign too. We're going to be recruiting volunteers to help us gather signatures, which is how we get on the ballot here in California, and we need your help in all of this. So thank you so much for your participation in the ACLU and for having me here with you this afternoon.
Kelli has about five to seven minutes for questions, and then she's going to leave it too.
Yes.
Are there going to be any changes in the way why African Americans are getting just a tremendous amount of time for a few rocks of crack cocaine, for someone to get caught for an ounce of powder cocaine?
That's an issue. Thank you for the question. And the question was, for people who didn't hear, is are there going to be any changes for the disparity between the way our government, the way our law enforcement treats crack cocaine versus powder cocaine? Crack cocaine involves significantly higher sentences than powder cocaine. And if you look at the demographics of people that use both drugs, there are more minorities that use crack cocaine and more whites that use powder cocaine, and there are much more lenient sentences for powder cocaine. This is an issue that the ACLU across the country has been working on for years. At the federal level, earlier this year, we were able to get a bill passed that lowered a lot of the disparity. Didn't get rid of it completely, but brought it down significantly on the federal level. So we're really, really happy about that. On the state level, drug reform is something that is part and parcel of the criminal justice reform that I spoke of. We are working very hard to rationalize all of our drug penalties. They're way too high. We did a poll of Californians across the state earlier this year. We used a polling firm, and we polled Democrats, Republicans, Independents all across California. We asked them their opinions about drug penalties in the state. And first of all, people were shocked that you can, for simple possession of a small amount of drugs for personal use, so not people who have drugs with the intention of selling them, but people who have a small amount of drugs for personal use, the people we polled were shocked to find out that's a felony in California, and it's punishable for up to 3 years in state prison. People were blown away by that, really, really shocked and disgusted. And when we asked people an open-ended question, well, how do you think, what do you think the penalty should be? A lot of people said it should maybe be a ticket or maybe up to 6 months in jail, but wouldn't it make more sense to do drug treatment or to do something other than locking people up in prison who possess a small amount of drugs? So that's an issue that we're working on, trying to bring down all of those drug penalties and divert, you know, to have our system treat drugs and drug addiction as a public health matter first and foremost, rather than a criminal justice matter. Here, and then we'll come up here.
First of all, thank you for coming to our little city here.
I went to law school at UC Davis, so this is my area, you know.
Okay. I agree with everything that ACLU is doing, although sometimes I don't think they're doing enough. Like one thing that I think they're very weak on is voting rights. Like last year, voters in California passed Proposition 14, which really reduced the voting rights of people in California by the promise of people getting more choices. And in fact, what's happening is that the general elections were going to be reduced from six and sometimes seven choices down to maybe two choices at most. Mm-hmm. And so no independent candidate would be allowed to qualify for the November ballot. None of the third parties would be qualified for the November ballot. They won't even count write-in votes in November. So it sounds like a great restriction on voters' rights in California. And I'd like to know if ACLU has any position or anybody kind of position on that.
It's something we will definitely take a look at. It's not an area that we've been actively involved in because of limited resources. Unfortunately, there are so many critical civil liberties and civil rights issues facing us, we're not able to get involved in the first place, or certainly to the degree that we'd like on all the important issues, but it's certainly something that we take a look at. In California, we have three staffed ACLU offices, our Northern California office here in San Francisco, and legislators in Sacramento. We also have an office in Los Angeles and an office in San Diego. And the redistricting issue is something that the San Diego office this year has been able to, through the accumulation of some additional resources and the hiring of an attorney who has specific expertise in voting rights issues, really take that on locally in terms of the impact in their counties down there. But it is an important issue that we care about, but our office has not been directly involved in it recently, which is why we need more members and more support. I had a question here, then we'll come up here.
Thank you for a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
Can you give some other examples of activist locals that serve as a really positive adjunct to the legal team? I would like our local ACLU to become more prominent mm-hmm. and out there and find ways of doing projects, and not talking, but doing things. Mm-hmm. Of course, that will involve talking. So are there other kind of really great locals that just kind of go in full bore that you can tell us about?
Yeah, there is a variety, and what I would encourage folks to do is we have such talented organizing staff. Our organizing and community engagement staff is really, really talented, and they're happy to set up a meeting with you all to brainstorm issues of way we could partner together in a really impactful way. There are lots of examples. We have folks that are on the ground working on education issues who are connecting with community-based organizations and students and parents and doing Know Your Rights work in the same way you're doing some police and immigration Know Your Rights work, doing that for students, others who are doing it on police issues as well, and we are working with some folks to do advocacy directly with the school district in combination with community-based organizations and with parent and student groups. That's just one example. There are also chapters who, from time to time, have taken on local voting issues. We have a chapter who they were going to change the timing of their local elections to basically try to disenfranchise the college student population. They were going to move the election from September to July or something like that, which would involve the large college population, which tended to be more liberal, more progressive, not having a voice. The chapter got involved with a coalition of groups and got them to reverse that the direction they were going in, so the voting schedule remained the same, so the college students are able to vote. So it's just another example. There are lots of them, and Shana Gellander is the director of our organizing and community engagement department, and we'd be delighted to set up a time to brainstorm things, depending on, we should tailor it based on what the needs and what the interests are here in Sacramento. There's not really a cookie-cutter approach or process. I do know, however, that with respect to the death penalty campaign that I mentioned, we kind of need and want all hands on deck in the ACLU for this campaign. That's the only way we're going to win this campaign. And so I know some information went out from our staff on Friday to your chapter board about ways to get the chapter involved in the Safe California campaign to replace the death penalty with life without the possibility of parole. I would really encourage you all, if it's an issue that you're interested in, to work with us on that campaign, because there will be so many great opportunities and we need all hands on deck to be successful. I had this gentleman in the blue shirt.
The last time we had the ballot measure go to on the death penalty, the people of California voted for the death penalty and it went to the state Supreme Court. The state Supreme Court affirmed the decision of the people of the state of California. Now, you're starting the process over. What has changed that makes you think the people of the state of California will change their mind on what they previously have done?
It's a very good question. A lot has changed since then, and we've done very, very in-depth polling across the state, and Californians are fed up. I think they're starting to understand that it's not making us any safer, and it's costing our broke state a whole lot of money, that we can save a lot of money and still be safe. And we have a cross-section of law enforcement officials,
victims. These are murder victims, family members, and lawyers and others together who are leading this campaign together. We've done polling, but it's not just us. The Public Policy Institute of California just released a poll last week that shows that the majority, well over 60% of Californians, support ending the death penalty and replacing it with life without the possibility of parole. So it's not going to be easy, but public opinion, this is an issue that has changed. I think people just are fed up. And because our state is broke, it's again one of these perfect storm issues, they realize we can be safe and we can save a whole lot of money. We can save literally a billion dollars over 5 years if we get rid of the death penalty. Without releasing the single prisoner, requiring restitution, requiring work, and diverting some of those resources to help solve unsolved crimes. In my view, it should be a no-brainer. It's sort of...
It's educating the public.
It's educating the public, and a lot of that has happened. There have been some very prominent people who have, including retired judges, people that have been in the system. The former warden of San Quentin, Jeannie Woodford, who presided over executions as part of her job, presided over a number of executions. She is now the head of an organization called Death Penalty Focus, and she's leading this campaign with us, calling for an end to the death penalty. I think public opinions have changed. So we had... I think that's a great point. I think you're absolutely right. One moment. We have the gentleman in the yellow shirt, then we'll come to you. There was a person, and I'm unfortunately not remembering, a commentator on NPR yesterday or the day before, who said the execution of Troy Davis is going to be the best thing that we, the abolition movement, have had happen in a long time, because people all across the world were convinced of his innocence, yet the state of Georgia went forward. So we have the gentleman in the yellow shirt, and then back here.
What are you doing to keep the separation of church and state?
It depends on what the issue is. We are doing a fair bit. It plays out in very different contexts. It's interesting. We are doing a fair bit of work right now in the reproductive justice context. We do a lot of work to make sure that students have access to comprehensive, medically accurate, unbiased health information and information about sexuality. Well, we have found school districts who, all schools in California, all public schools are supposed to teach classes in health. We have found school districts that have hired ministers to teach, from a theistic point of view, teach health information. And in these cases that we've been involved in, the ministers have been, teaching these, have had abstinence-only curriculum that are religiously based, they're not medically accurate, they're not comprehensive. And so that's an example of us explaining to the school district, no, there has to be a separation between the church and the state. You're not allowed to have a minister come in and teach from a religious viewpoint, not to mention medically inaccurate information. So it depends on the context in which it comes up. We had a student contact us just before the beginning of the school year who was concerned about having to have certain Bible assignments as part of his literature class. So it's an issue that we remain vigilant on, and it plays out in very, very different ways. But the gentleman back here.
I just wanted to make a comment that you talked about the former warden of San Quentin. Jeannie actually rose above that level, and prior to retiring from the Department of Corrections, was the top ranking official. She was the acting secretary of the California Department of Corrections.
That's right. Thank you. That's right. I think we have time maybe for two more questions. One here, and then in the back row.
Okay, I'll stand, so I won't turn my back. But I just wanted to say thank you. I agree with everyone who is thanking you for...
Well, thank you.
But what I'm particularly really, really excited about is, and grateful for, is your linkage between education, justice, and criminal justice. And that I'm the president of a group called the Restorative Schools Vision Project, and we are working. But I haven't met you before, but Diana's been down and talked to us. We're working with ACLU of Northern California. Deborah and I have had some conversations about, would love to involve this chapter if there's an interest in the work we're doing, because really what we, it's an important civil rights issue. It's about ending the school-to-prison pipeline, and that's exactly where those two things come together.
Diana's working with our San Mateo and our Fresno chapter, so, in answer to the gentleman's question, that is
so
an issue.
You had mentioned that there were some local chapters, and I just wanted to say that it would be great. It's been wonderful having the support of ACLU of Northern California, but how wonderful it would be if we're in some schools here and if we could have support here, we could really use it. And we're doing using the wonderful materials you guys have done on Know Your Rights and working with parents.
Great.
So thank you.
Great, thank you. Last question in the back.
I was wondering about cognitive disabilities and specifically also as it relates to law enforcement. And the example is, I had a 9-year-old boy, signed with nonverbal autism who was handcuffed, and then I read the articles in paper of, several 8 and 9-year-olds, just within the recent past in different locations. So I just wanted to inquire about that, and also kind of second what the lady was just saying, about the fact that there are a lot of different groups that have interests that, they can kind of divert like little streams, helping create a larger river. I mean, another group would be people with disabilities and cognitive disabilities. And, obviously, it's, everybody's overwhelmed, but if there was a way that we could make these connections across, these different organizations, I think we really could benefit and, feed each other and kind of create a larger group. And unfortunately, I kind of try to, push a little bit on that, but I know everybody's so busy that all these different organizations, I don't feel we really have used up all the potential that there is.
I think that's a great question. I mean, we're stronger united. We're stronger when there are more of us and we have a louder voice. And we, at the ACLU, we started last year a program called the Community Network Partnership Program, where we're trying to do exactly that, make strategic connections with organizations who are simpatico with us in terms of the world we want to see and the goals we're trying to accomplish, and try to look for ways of partnering where we can support one another. So I think that's something we all need to do more of. With respect to your question about law enforcement and people with cognitive disabilities, or I'll say other mental health issues, that's such a critically important area, and it's an area where our law enforcement entities across the country, including in California, are horribly undertrained on. When you look at police use of force incidents, particularly use of tasers and also lethal force, police shootings of people, an extremely high number of those involve people with mental health issues, and part of that is because police have not been trained adequately. In our advocacy in San Francisco last year and continuing into this year, the San Francisco Police Department right now does not have tasers. They want to get tasers. And we said, you guys are so screwed up. You can't manage the current tools that you have right now. You should not be looking to expand your arsenal unless and until you make sure that every single one of your officers is adequately trained, particularly on how to deal with people with mental health issues. Because we know that this is the population that's going to experience the brunt of this new weapon that's happened in city after city after city. Fortunately, there are some good resources. The key is to get law enforcement to embrace them. NAMI, which is an organization called the National Association for Mental Illness, I think I've got the acronym right, they actually have partnered with a number of law enforcement agencies across the country, progressive-minded law enforcement agencies, to do really meaningful, great training that has had an incredible result in terms of reducing police use of force incidents, because one of the things that it does is it trains police officers how to be better communicators, which is helpful to them in everything they do and everyone that they're communicating with. So it's a super important issue, and one that we bring up with law enforcement a lot, because when you drill down and look at people that are being impacted the most and deficiencies in training, that's often a big piece of the puzzle. I apologize. My daughter has a soccer game this afternoon, so I've got to run back to San Francisco, but I've really enjoyed being here with you today.
Thank you.
Thank you.